tucked away in the wooded hills of Dortmund, Germany, lies the casino Hohenseeberg. And if you go down to the woods today, you're sure of a big surprise.
Oh yes, a big, big surprise, all right. Now, Dortmund might be affectionately known by the locals as a green metropolis, but we woke up this morning and it was all white. Now, as glorious as this setting is, the EPT is in town. That means that every pro that ever there was is gathered here because they heard a 930,000 euro top prize was up for grabs. But of the 411 who started, only 8 remain. And today is the day that one of them walks away with the EPT title and a massive cash prize. And one thing's for certain, it'll be no picnic.
Yes, big money up for grabs here in Dortmund. 411 players entered this, the seventh leg of the fourth season of the EPT. We have a total prize pool of 3.1 million euros and a first prize of 933,000. It's final table time. By the end of today, someone walks away with the trophy, the cash, and the champion's title. Will it be Mike McDonald from Canada? He is the chip leader. Diego Perez from Spain. He excels at poker and strategy games. Thibaut Durand is the short stack, just 148,000 in chips. Johannes Strassmann is a very aggressive German player. Christian Harder makes his second final table on this season of the EPT. Andreas Gullinet, he's new to the game, but he's doing well. As is fellow German newcomer Torsten Haas. Making up our final table, Claudio Rinaldi from Switzerland. And as the action begins at this final table, the blinds are 5,000 and 10,000 with a running ante of 1,000. Lee Jones is alongside me once again to analyze the action.
Well, we're going to have a lot of action, James, because the players here are all very aggressive, or most of them are anyway. This is Torsten Haas. He's actually one of the more passive players. But there's some people here that are going to be getting in there and pushing money around. And this is one of them, Mike McDonald, who's our chip leader. He's going to come in for a raise anytime he gets a chance. And 10-9 of diamonds is his chance.
27,000.
Suited connectors makes it 27,000 to play. He's got two big stacks to his left. This is one of them, Diego Perez.
Now, this is not a hand that plays well against a raiser.
Especially at a full table. Remember, we've still got 8 players.
He can re-raise and try to get Mike off the hand right now, but calling would be out of the question, I think. And it looks like he's loading up for a re-raise.
The brown chips are worth 5,000 apiece. The blues are 1,000. Those pink chips, 10,000 each.
Sure enough, that's a re-raise.
And Diego, raise.
72,000. And the action is on the short stack, Thibaut Durand from Paris in France.
Now the general rule is against competent players,
raising another 45,000.
If there's a raise and a re-raise in front of you, you have to have a premium hand to get involved. There's always a danger that the original raiser will come back over the top.
Durand has folded, Johannes Strassmann has folded, it's back on Mike McDonald.
45,000 for him to call.
He has about 830,000 now, so they're both extremely deep. He might very well choose to hit a flop and see if he can get something.
I think he just said raise.
He did indeed. This is power poker, James.
And Mike is going to re-raise.
I said there was going to be action. He knows that Perez knows that he's raising light, so he's just coming right back in. This is what they call third-level thinking.
And Perez has a look on his face that says, okay, I gave it a try, it didn't work.
He says, I know I raise light sometimes, but this time I really have it.
It's going to cost him 100,000 to call.
In traditional poker parlance, that re-raise says, it may be jacks, but probably not.
Perez knows A6 is probably no good here. He mucks. And Mike McDonald, hats off to you, sir.
Absolutely. This is the kind of poker that I love to watch. Somebody who is thinking about what his opponent is thinking and thinks one level further than that and takes a pot away with essentially nothing.
He started the day as chip leader. He's going to use that stack to bully the other players and consolidate that chip lead. What a way to start this final table. I mean, all EPT final tables are exciting, but when you've got hands like that, we're in heaven.
James, I do this job so I can watch poker hands like that. The intensity, that Mike McDonald brought to that one moment in poker history was spectacular. He put the raise in, he got re-raised. Most of us would say, okay, fine, I gave it a shot and let it go. He thought about it and just came right back over the top with that third raise, and it was spectacular. I loved it.
And we've got some strong characters at this table. We've got Mike McDonald, we've got Johannes Strassman, Diego Perez, and these guys are going to tangle.
Absolutely. And don't forget Christian Harder. These guys have lots of experience online. They're used to playing for high stakes, and they're not going to be afraid to mix it up here.
It promises to be great stuff. Blinds have gone up, 6,000, 12,000. Still a 1,000 running ante. And this is really putting the pressure now on players like Thibaut Durand.
Right, he's got fewer than five big blinds left, James. He's going to have to get involved in a hand soon.
Christian Pass.
This is Andreas Goulenay. He's got 5-6 of spades. He started the day with about 550,000 in chips.
Andreas raised to 30,000.
So once again, one of the rules of good poker is it doesn't matter what you have when you raise. It matters what you have when you call, but you can raise with any two cards.
Well, he's run into ace-jack in the hands of Mike McDonald.
Mike call.
And he's going to flat call position there, Lee.
It's position and Mike's perception of his ability against Goulenay. He knows, and is probably correct, that he can play Goulenay after the flop and take advantage of the position. He also is afraid that Goulenay doesn't know when to get away from a hand the way Diego Perez got away from the last hand.
Big blind pass.
The blinds fold. Two players going to the flop. Goulenay wants the raiser, and he'll be first to speak once the first three community cards are dealt.
And the flop is 6, Trey.
And he's hit his 6.
Andreas is first to speak.
Nothing for Mike McDonald.
Right, and this is actually, for a 6-5 suited raise, this is a tolerable flop. He's got second pair
Andreas
and three of his flush. And three to a straight, too.
The bet's 50,000. Mike McDonald knows how this guy plays. He has to be careful here about making some kind of move with just ace high.
I don't think he's going to make the move. That king, as soon as I say he's not going to make the move,
Mike is going to
the word raise comes out of his mouth. Basically, he's telling Goulenay he has a king. He's going to invest 140,000 to see if Goulenay has a king.
140,000.
Problem is, when Goulenay catches a piece of the flop, he kind of gets committed to it.
Yes, he does. But I think he's probably developed some respect for Mike over the tournament. He's out of position. McDonald can crush him with his chips.
If he doesn't believe Mike, would the correct strategy be to push?
Michael.
Interesting.
Well, instead he just calls.
I think this is going to be very difficult for him unless he picks up something else on the turn. But what is he hoping to pick up? Virtually any card that comes, unless it's a 4 or a spade or a 5,
here's the turn,
is going to miss him.
It's a jack.
Well, now Mike McDonald has hit his jack. Now Goulenay's moved behind.
Here's his first trick.
He has, of course, got the spade draw. He's now moved all in. That's the move surely he should have made against Mike McDonald's flop raise.
Exactly.
What?
How much is that?
He should have done that earlier, and now he's gotten himself in on the turn with only one card to come.
Maybe you get one more.
There's a Goulenay admirer. Now, Mike's got second pair top kicker. He's got to worry about that king, though.
If Goulenay had a king, he would have raised before. He may be thinking king jack.
No idea what you have.
Goulenay's played the hand completely backwards, and so Mike is just confused.
I don't really believe you.
Call it.
I was bluffing the flop, but I think my hand is good.
He's worked it out.
You can see.
Maybe You have King Jack? You have King Jack?
That's what he's worried about. He's worried about King Jack.
This might be bad, but I call.
He's made the call, and it's a good call.
It's a very good call.
Mike makes the call.
Gulenay is at risk. He will need to hit a six of five or a spade, or he is the first player out.
Hand for Andreas. Andreas has a pair of six and a flush draw.
He's standing up.
So right now, Mike is in the lead.
He knows it's almost over.
Andreas is the all-in player. He needs to catch a six or a five or a spade.
He's got 14 outs.
He will be our eighth place finisher. And here comes the river card.
Mike McDonald very happy about his call.
And it is?
The river card is a five. It's two pairs for Andreas Gulenay. He sucks out on Mike McDonald. And he doubles up. I think he's happy.
Come on, I love the river. I love the river.
It's great when you've played a hand well, but sometimes it feels even better to get lucky.
Mike McDonald knows that he made a very good call. And that, James, is going to be a key. Emotionally balanced, no matter whether things go well or poorly, whereas Gulenay is going up and down with the swings.
Welcome back to Casino Hohenzollern in Dortmund, Germany. It is freezing out here, but the action is really hotting up on the final table, so let's get in there.
That's the money they're playing for, €933,000 for the winner. The next man out will get
€85,500.
Now this is Christian Harder. He's a student from Annapolis in Maryland. You might remember him from the final table of the PokerStars Caribbean Adventure.
This is two straight final tables for him, James, and it is a record that is tied only with Ramaswamy.
Comes in with a raise.
Raising it up with Ace King, making it 32,000 to play.
Andreas pass.
Folded by Andreas and Torsten and Claudio.
Claudio pass.
Mike McDonald's got pocket aces.
Uh-oh, this is going to be trouble for Charter.
Raise.
And Mike is going to raise.
He wants Christian to come in. He doesn't know that he's not going to have any difficulty getting Christian's chips in the pot.
Raises to 105,000.
It's a big raise.
That's right, it's a big raise. He doesn't want anybody coming in behind him in the pot. He wants him versus Christian Harder and nobody else.
Well, Strassman is not going to get involved with that junk hand, so it's back on Christian Harder.
Christian's acting like he's thinking about it. And he probably is. I mean, he knows that Mike is a strong player. He knows that Mike knows he's a strong player. But I don't think he can get away from Ace King here. Is it Ace King? Yep, it's the same Ace King it was before I checked back.
He pushes all in.
Re-raise all in.
Insta call from Mike McDonald.
Did you see how quickly Mike called? That was really a courtesy to his friend. He said, sorry, guy. And they just stood up and shook hands.
Christian hand is ace king.
Bad timing is what it is. Aces against ace king. Christian Harder with just a 7% chance of staying in this event.
Flop comes. Check, deuce, king.
Wow, at least he's hit a king.
Now he's got two outs.
Two hearts in there. Right now, ace
running hearts as well for a flush.
Christian needs another king at this point. Let's see the turn card.
No, it's fun when these cards just like heart.
Turn card is a queen.
It's a heart.
Oh my, and it's a queen. That gives Christian the tens as well.
Tens, hearts, kings.
Or a ten or a heart.
I'll take a ten.
Let's see the river card.
Yes, he would.
The river card.
Noise. Okay. Noise.
Is a blank. The aces hold up. Christian Harder is the first player out at our final table here in Dortmund. He finishes in eighth place and he wins himself €85,500. And as you say, Lee, we have to pay credit to this guy. Two final tables back to back.
Absolutely. And he and Mike are actually good friends having breakfast together, but there's no friends at the poker table, James.
Thibaut Durand started as the short stack. He's still the short stack. He's managed to cling on, and he's moved up the money ladder, that's for sure. And look what's happened at the top of the table. Johannes Strassmann is our new chip leader. Andreas Gullinet is second. Mike McDonald has slipped back to third.
First off the final table here, unfortunately, in Dortmund is American Christian Harder. Now, we did think you might go all the way. This is your second final table, though, in as much as a month here on the EPT. You only just started playing live. Two final tables. You must be quite happy about that.
Yeah, it's very happy. I mean, I'm very happy, obviously. I'm a little disappointed but at the results, the 8th and the 7th. But at the same time, I mean, it's pretty amazing.
It is pretty amazing, considering you've just started playing live. Like, we obviously know you as an online player, but this is a real step up in game. Now, you said that you weren't going to shy away from confrontations with Mike. You still happy about that?
Yeah, I mean, I can't ever fold there, I don't think, especially against him. There's no way I could fold. So, just the cooler just happens, but oh well.
So, seven players. And this guy is the chip leader right now, Johannes Strassmann.
He is probably the most aggressive player we have at the table, along with Mike McDonald. And for him, pocket threes is plenty to raise with.
Johannes raised to 36,000.
Makes it 36,000.
He's very fortunate to have...
Oh, Torsten Haas, pocket aces.
I was going to say he has passive players behind him, but even the most passive player can get aggressive when he finds aces.
Bit of an unconvincing acting job from Haas.
Thorsten, ich weiß nicht, ob ich dir unfolden kann, wenn du all-in gehst.
English only, please.
Yes, do please speak English only. It's been a problem this tournament.
Yes, there's been quite a few of the locals speaking in German, but it's understandable. They're on their home turf.
Thomas Kremser, our tournament director, enforcing the rules.
Raise.
Thorsten was a cat playing with a mouse there. Now I'm done playing. Now I'm going to bite you in half.
95.
It's now 95,000.
95,000.
And Strassmann surely knows this is a guy who doesn't mess around.
Exactly. If it's Mike McDonald or Diego Perez, he has to think about it. Against Thorsten Haas, his threes are no darn good, and he knows it.
Small blind pass.
The blinds get out of the way.
Big blind pass.
Six.
How much more is it in total, please?
You don't care. You just want to throw the hand away. Trust me.
He's actually deciding if he has the price to come in against Ace King.
The raise is 59,000.
And he has behind?
19.
Okay, I call. Needed to call. I call.
A flat call.
You said call now.
Oh, he's confused.
He thought Thorsten was all in.
So 59,000. Johannes, 59,000.
Bush?
Well, actually, he saved himself from months of money there.
59?
Yes, unless he flops a set, he's going to get away from the flop very quickly. And look at him. He's completely confused and out of whack now, James. He's made a huge mistake. He knows it.
Wenn er seine Karten aufdecken würde, würden die klar gefoldet werden, oder?
Nee. Here comes the flop.
Ach so, die werden offen weitergespielt?
Will there be a three on the flop? No.
Flop comes 10, 4, 8. Johannes is first to speak.
I call.
He's all in and call.
Okay, this has been a very weird, very unconventional hand.
Yes, pocket aces.
Do you know what? Johannes got completely tilted by the mistake he had made
and
walked right into it. He decided that Thorsten had ace king and he just completely blew it here.
Make it lower.
Strassmann needs to hit a three. There are two of them in the deck. One card to come.
5%.
And is nine, and Thorsten
the aces hold up. Thorsten Haas doubles up, and Johannes Strassmann really needs to focus a bit better on what's going on at the table.
He got tilted there, James, and he needs to collect himself very quickly.
One man who's celebrating that mistake is Thorsten Haas. Well, if only Johannes Strassmann could hear our commentary, he might have known what was happening in that hand. He got a bit confused, didn't he?
He did, James, and that's so important to stay focused. He got confused about what was going on at the table, thought he was calling it all in when it wasn't, And then the worst thing was is that when that happened, he just got completely tilted, pushed all his chips in immediately on the flop, and got insta-called by aces.
Yeah, you mentioned the F word, focus, and that's the lesson to learn here, isn't it? Always follow the action, always know what's going on.
You follow the action, you pay attention, and if you do get confused, you stop, you ask questions, you find out what the situation is, then you recenter yourself and move forward.
Well, hopefully that's a lesson that Strassman has now learned. Seven players remain from the 411 that we started with a few days ago.
There's Claudio Rinaldi. He says 10-9 is not good enough.
Diego Perez, 5-deuce offsuit. Thibaut Duron has been nursing that short stack for ages. He's finally making a move with it. All in for his last 59,000.
He's waited too long. That's just a drop in the bucket for Strassman.
Who's got pocket eights? Who's got a hand? There are the blinds behind him.
He's likely to re-raise and try to get people out.
Okay, sure enough. Is going to raise.
155.
Raise to 155.
A total of 155,000. So now, unless the blinds have got a really big hand,
right,
they'll quickly go out.
Thorsten is in a big blind.
Gulenay's folded from the small blind. Torsten Haas with Jack 7 of hearts will surely give up his big blind. Preferably today.
He's not thinking about it, is he?
Okay.
No.
There we go.
Yeah, good luck.
Okay, Torsten Haas.
So, Thibaut Duron is all in with the ace four. Johannes Strassman in the lead with the pocket eights. Just the one overcard. Duron's best chance to double up and stay in the tournament is to hit that ace.
And a very nice gesture between the two gentlemen, shaking hands before the cards come down.
Ace four, all in hand for Thibaut, pocket eights for Johannes, and here is the flop.
Strassman's thinking, at least I'm ahead this time when we go into an all-in situation.
Flop comes, queen, four, king.
My goodness, that gives him a pair and the runner-runner flush draw. So now he needs a four or an ace.
All running spades.
Or an ace for a second pair. Here's the turn.
Turn card.
Turn card is an eight.
Eight, that gives Strassman a set, and that means the hand's over.
Absolutely, he was drawing dead.
Three eights for Johannes
Strassman has eliminated Thibaut Duron. He is the seventh place finisher in this tournament. He will take home to France €120,000. And we now have a six-handed table here in Dortmund on the European Poker Tour. Action continues after this short break. Welcome back to the EPT final table here in Dortmund, Germany. And let's recap quickly on the action so far. We've already lost two players. First to go was PCA final tablist Christian Harder, his ace-king blown out of the water by Mike McDonald's pocket aces. Johannes Strassman then kindly doubled up Torsten Haas, aces yet again taking down the pot. But this didn't slow Strassman down, though. Shortly afterwards, he was the man responsible for knocking out Thibaut Duron. He finished in seventh place.
And this is the decision.
So let's take a look at how the chip stacks stand. Well, most of the action's been between the top four. The chips have been up and down. Torsten won a huge pot against Gulenay, rocketing him to the top. Gulenay then took a load from McDonald. Strassman hasn't put the brakes on, still been playing hyper-aggressive poker, and has been frittering away his chips. Christian Harder, our eighth place finisher, now watching from the stands. Do you suspect he's supporting Mike McDonald, Lee?
He and Mike are good friends. I'm sure he's rooting for Mike to go all the way.
Blinds are up, 10,000, 20,000. The running ante now 2,000. And of course, with the action six-handed, you have to adjust your play. Starting requirements come down slightly.
Absolutely, and it's going to be interesting to see if players such as Torsten Haas and Claudio Rinaldi can make that adjustment.
Action's been folded round to Mike McDonald. 18 years old from Canada. Not going to play this hand, so it's now on Diego Perez. with queen nine. He's on the button.
This is plenty hand to raise with on the button. He's been very quiet so far. He should have some credibility with his opponents. He's thinking so long about it though, James, he's gonna lose that credibility.
We couldn't see his eyes behind those shades. I was wondering whether he dozed off.
Just enjoying having the camera on him, I suppose. But he is going to raise. Looks like 60,000.
Yeah, those pink chips, 10,000 each.
Makes it 60,000 to play.
That's getting funny.
Johannes Strassmann folds from the small blind. It's Andreas Goulenet in the big blind. He's got 7-8 suited.
I raise.
Give him full credit for raising here. It's going to be extremely difficult for Perez to call. And I think Perez's delay is what got him into this trouble. Goulenet said if he had ace king, he had an immediate raise.
Strong move from Andreas. Diego Perez is now putting on a show.
I don't think he can possibly call. Oh, what card does he want to see? Unless the flop comes 8-10 jack.
Maybe he's fallen asleep again.
I think this has to be for our benefit, James. He surely can't try to play. And as soon as I say that, he calls.
It's a very strange call. Yes, he's got position, but he's not got a spectacular hand.
If he flops top pair, and he's not going to have any idea of where he stands in the hand. Now, obviously, Goulenet doesn't like this at all. He's about to play out of position in a monster pot with 8-7 suited.
But he is in the driving seat at the moment.
And the flop comes. Ace, tray, check.
First player that bets wins the pot.
Andreas is first.
And Andreas immediately reaches for chips.
He can represent an ace now. And that's exactly what he's going to do.
That's a strong bet.
Absolutely. He gets great credit for that play, James. He followed through with the re-raise with what we call the continuation bet. Perez is done, and there's nothing he can do about it at this point.
Perez is actually ahead in the hand, as we can see from the percentages, but he's got no way of knowing that. And quite frankly, what's going through his brain now is, why didn't I fold before the flop?
Exactly.
He is not putting Goulenet on 7-8 suited. He's putting him on an ace, or at least a jack.
Absolutely. There's nothing he's going to do. The other thing he might be thinking is if he pushes all in, can he move Goulenet off of a jack or something? But
too risky.
It's too risky, especially against Goulenet, because if Goulenet had any ace, he's coming after him. And probably any jack, too.
Oh, fold already.
He really doesn't have enough to raise him off the hand at this point, and he knows it.
He mucks the hand. And the crowd are very happy that Andreas Goulenet took that one down.
It was an incredibly strong play by Goulenet.
Probably the best hand we've seen him play yet.
Hello, I'm Andreas. I come from Germany. And I'm 26 years old. I'm a gambler. I call with a high card. I read my opponent and then I call with a high card. To this come up. I'm a gambler. My biggest win is this one. This is my first tournament and I win my first tournament.
Apparently he's a gambler.
Well, we've seen that from watching the hands.
His biggest successes so far have actually come at blackjack rather than poker, but he says he's playing to win today.
After that last hand, he definitely was.
Diego Perez has got jack 10.
And apparently he has to have a think about this one too.
I'm still convinced they're power naps.
Those pink ones he's counting out are worth 10,000 each.
The browns are 5,000, the blues at 1,000.
60,000.
Ace 9 in the hands of Johannes Strassmann.
Now from Diego, who we haven't seen raise much, you might let that ace 9 go. But Strassmann doesn't know where the break is.
140
re-raise. It's a re-raise to 140,000. In
this case, it'll work.
Andreas folds the small blind. Torsten Haas folds the big blind.
Small blind pass, big blind pass.
Back on Diego.
Back to Diego. He's in for 60.
Now, he may be getting tired of being pushed around.
The shades have come off.
Fascinating. If he makes a move here, Strassmann's going to have to take it seriously.
All in.
He's made the move. All in.
Diego re-raised. All in.
Strassmann wants a count.
That's the third raise. He came in for a raise. Strassmann re-raised, and he's pushed all in.
Yeah, I can put your glasses. Yeah. Glasses are down.
It's a tell. It's a tell.
And Strassmann's picked up on the fact that the glasses came off.
Yes, but he doesn't know what to do with that fact. Is this the first time you've made a move with Jack 10, or is this the first time you've gotten kings?
Why did you put the glasses down? Why did you put down the glasses? Why did you put down the glasses?
Johannes, he doesn't speak English. You're wasting your time.
You're feeling like lucky? You're feeling lucky.
Maybe.
340 more?
338. He's not going to call with ace 9.
The only danger is if he thinks Perez is making the move with something like pocket 8s, in which case he's essentially a coin toss. He's actually in front. But
I'm going to fold it.
Yes.
Pass, and Diego wins.
It wasn't worth taking a chance.
No.
The fold.
Perez says good fold.
I tell you, in the break.
And the sunglasses go back on. Well, I can tell you, Perez and Strassmann don't just face off over the felt.
Two of the players here on our final table play StarCraft and WarCraft. Now, what does that mean? Well, a man who knows exactly what that means is Elky, because you were at the top of that game. Do you want to explain what that means, first of all?
Well, StarCraft is a real-time strategy game, so it can kind of be compared to chess, with a game where you have to think really quick and also act really quick with mouse and keyboard. Mm-hmm. But you really have to outsmart players. It's kind of like poker, that you have to be thinking one step ahead of them. So it's very important for StarCraft players to have this kind of analysis of the, because it's a game of incomplete information. Mm. So it's similar in poker, like when you play StarCraft against somebody, you just know a few things about his game. So you have to kind of predict his next move, and then you can anticipate his next move and play accordingly. So that's, I think, that's the really main thing in StarCraft and poker.
Mike McDonald looks down at 7-3 of diamonds and quickly folds. Action has been passed around to Gulenay, who raised it up on the button with ace-5 offsuit.
I love the panache with which he just tosses chips into the pot. It's hard on the dealer, but it looks good.
An all-in from Claudio Rinaldi in the big blind.
From Claudio.
Wow.
A big move with not much of a hand.
Picked the wrong guy to make this move against.
In case you didn't know, he's from Switzerland.
340 mehr.
His problem is that he's made a move on a guy that has difficulty folding a hand, James.
Surely Gulenay won't call the 389,000 with just ace 5.
If it were anybody else, I would say absolutely not. But this is Andreas Gulenay. And this is not for the camera. He's seriously thinking about calling. The guy says he's a gambler. He's a gambler.
He shows the ace and folds. Rinaldi getting a lot of support from the crowd as he shows the bluff, as he shows the fact that he moved all in with Queen 6 offsuit.
I thought the Swiss were supposed to be reserved and unemotional. They're going crazy up there in the stands for him.
Well, Gulenay's finally learned how to lay down a hand.
Hats off to Andreas for laying that hand down. And you know, he was wrong this time, but he's learning that you're allowed to put an ace down without going all in.
Yeah, he's casting aspersions about the state of his kicker.
And he was right. If it had been ace jack, it would have been fine to put the money in.
But success there for Claudio Rinaldi. He's 22 years old. He's from Lugano in Switzerland. He's a former casino croupier, and over the last 3 years, he's enjoyed some success on the poker circuit, including an 18th place finish at the 2007 PokerStars Caribbean Adventure. There's the case of money, 933,000 euros, the trophy that goes with it. Which of these six players will be lifting that at the end of today?
It could easily be this guy right here, Diego Perez.
The hyper-aggressive Johannes Strassmann also in with a shot, of course.
His aggression has stood him in good stand so far.
Andreas Gulenay has King Jack, and he will raise. 60,000 is the bet.
60.
Remember, raise. The table is now six-handed. King Jack, raise a better hand than it would be at a full table, raise. But against Ace King, pretty worthless. Will it be another all-in? It is.
And this is very interesting, because Gulenay may say, okay, I'm not putting up with this a second time. It'll be a huge mistake if he does.
It's actually great time for Rinaldi to pick up a premium hand.
The timing
like that.
Was absolutely perfect for him.
My God.
You can sense his frustration here.
That's the second time, and I just don't know if he's able to lay it down twice. But yes, this is so good for Rinaldi. He basically set it up with the previous hand, and now he has an opportunity to get Gulenay in with way the best of it.
Now, I said that King Jack is a reasonably strong hand on a six-handed table, but when you are facing an all-in, suddenly its value decreases massively.
It's nothing at this point. His very best hope is that Rinaldi has a small pair and he's essentially a coin toss. But there's too good a chance that he's what we call dominated, and in this case, that's exactly the situation. They have a card shared, the king, but Rinaldi has the bigger kicker.
Gulenay's been thinking for quite a while. And Thomas Krems, the tournament director, has put the clock on him. He's got 60 seconds to make his decision.
One of the players said, I'm done waiting for him. He gets 1 minute.
He doesn't need the minute. He's folded.
And that was a great fold on his part. And you know, we're seeing him grow into his game here on camera. It's a great thing to watch.
He may be frustrated now, but when he watches this back on TV, he'll be very happy about how he played that hand.
That's totally right, James. It really comes down to playing quality poker. You can't control what the cards are. It's your decisions that matter.
Action is on Torsten Haas. He's got ace-nine.
This will be an insta-raise for a number of the players at this table. And six-handed, it should be a raise.
When he's capped his cards, a sign that he will probably enter this pot.
No. Or not.
Torsten pass.
His inexperience is showing.
Or no, maybe he knew.
Yeah, maybe he knew something.
Whoa. Hang on a second.
That was a mistake. And once again, two mistakes in a row, both of which worked out well.
We should stress, though, against Mike unknown hands, ace-nine and ace-jack are perfectly playable. They don't know that Mike McDonald's
no,
got pocket kings.
They don't know that. And it's very interesting that they've both done the wrong thing and have gotten away with it.
Diego so the pass. Raise from McDonald, 55,000 with the kings. Johannes Strassmann, is that 7-8 he's got there?
All in. Johannes, re-raise.
That's what we call an error of timing.
He's walked right into it.
Big blind pass.
An immediate call from Mike McDonald. Hardly surprising, he's got pocket kings.
Mike says, if you have aces, nice hand, sir.
7-8 of hearts for Sebastian.
Strassmann. So he's not looking happy.
Johannes is the all-in player with 7-8 of hearts.
Funny that, when you consider he's got two undercards to the pocket pair of Mike McDonald.
Let's see the flop.
And one of the favorites to win the tournament is about to go out unless he gets very, very lucky.
And the flop comes. First card is a king.
Oh my goodness, James, he's drawing dead right now. He has no outs.
Dead on the flop, Johannes Strassmann exits the tournament in sixth place. €152,000. Mike McDonald now has more than $1 million in chips. We are down to five here in Dortmund, ever closer to crowning the champion of this leg of the EPT. Welcome back to Dortmund, where we've just lost Johannes Strassmann in sixth position.
Now, this was a really aggressive final table. There's a lot of massive all-ins that we're seeing up in the press room and on the live feed. So would you have played this any differently?
No, I'm very fine with how I played the end. You know, I played for first place. I didn't play for a second, third, fourth or fifth. You know, I just wanted to win this event. That was my goal. And I think the play makes a lot of sense.
Well, what do you think of the rest of the players at the table at the moment? There is still a lot of all-in action happening.
Definitely the best player left is Mike McDonald. I really, really hope that Mike McDonald is going to win this thing because, in my opinion, he's the best player left, and I always like if the best player prevails.
The blinds are up, 15 and 30,000 now, with a running ante of 3,000.
Just five players left. That makes those pocket sevens an extremely strong hand.
Andreas Gullinet is counting out the raise.
Looks like 90,000.
That would be three times the big blind.
80.
Andreas raised to 80,000.
80,000 is the bet. A little less than we expected.
Torsten Pass.
Claudio Rinaldi, he's got ace nine.
And it looks like they're suited. I think I saw the point of a diamond under there.
I'm all in.
He's all in. Claudio, well, I guarantee you this time, Gullinet will not fold.
No, Gullinet's going to jump pass. Right in there.
Diego Paz comes back to Andreas.
He doesn't like it.
He's got too much of a hand this time on a five-handed table.
And I think Rinaldi made a mistake. He showed his bluff.
And call.
Gullinet has made the call. Rinaldi shows the ace nine. He's got two overcards. It's practically a coin flip. The sevens are a slight favorite. But remember, Rinaldi is the player at risk here. He had fewer chips at the start of the hand.
Claudio's all in.
And I think by showing the bluff earlier, James, he got Gullinet thinking, I can make this play with no hand. And that's why he got called. He didn't want to be called.
Up comes 9-3-4.
So far, so good for the pocket sevens. Rinaldi looking to hit an ace or a nine, all running diamonds.
In the lead with pocket sevens. Here is the turn. Turn card is a king of diamonds. Now we got two diamonds on the board.
There are two diamonds on board. The flush draw is good.
But of course, the seven of diamonds won't help him.
And nine or
that would give Gullinet a full house.
Let's see the river card.
Here comes the river card.
It's a five.
Five of spades is a blank. Gullinet wins the hand and eliminates Claudio Rinaldi.
Fifth place finisher.
Who shakes the hand of his opponent. The locals are loving it.
They're envisioning a German champion right there in Dortmund.
A lot of support for Andreas Gullinet and commiserations to Claudio Rinaldi. Gullinet now has the chip lead, nearly 1.3 million. Mike McDonald with $1 million in chips. Torsten Haas and Diego Perez still pretty reasonably stacked. And Rinaldi, for finishing fifth, will pick up €193,000. Tell you what, Lee, I hope that attaché case has got good locks.
It's being carefully watched by EPT staffers.
Seeing a list of previous EPT champions. We'll add another name to that list tonight. One of four men will be crowned champion of Dortmund. Diego Perez has pocket twos.
And Diego Reyes.
The bet is 75,000. It's been folded to Torsten Haas. With king six off suit.
Now, the interesting thing is that anything is two over cards to Perez's hand. And Perez knows it.
Torsten has been quite a solid player. We wouldn't expect him to get creative with a hand like this.
No, it would be very unlike him. But the interesting thing is that if he makes a move, he's got the credibility to get away with it.
How much do you have? Chips?
No, there's some chips. He's not going to.
My goodness, he is seriously thinking about it. And that question has got to put some fear into Diego Perez. He does not want any action with those pocket deuces.
Call. Well, that's the move I didn't expect. I thought we'd see either a big raise or a fold.
This is Torsten Haas's inexperience showing here, James.
Torsten check.
He's got a straight draw.
He checked. No, you don't check here. You bet.
He's looking for a 4 or a 9 to make the straight. At the moment, the twos are still in the lead.
You don't care about your hand. It doesn't matter. If he comes in with a bet right here, the hand is over. Now he's given the momentum to Diego, and Diego is not going to let it go.
If Diego makes a bet.
100,000.
It's 100,000.
Maybe Haas wanted to check raise?
If he does a check raise here, he's my hero.
300.
And that's exactly what he's done.
Raised to 300,000.
My respect for Torsten Haas has just skyrocketed, James. That was a beautiful play. There's no way Perez calls here. He's just getting TV time at this point. Even if he puts Haas on a draw, Haas will have 14 outs twice.
Look at the percentages. Haas is the statistical favorite. He's got two overcards to the twos. He's got the straight draw. He's got the backdoor flush draw.
And if the board came, for instance, 5-7, then the two pairs would counterfeit Perez, and Haas's king would play. That's why he is statistically in front.
And that's why Perez has laid down the deuces. Haas takes it down.
Spectacular play there, James.
Push.
Next time.
I call for sure. Believe me.
Este me calea la próxima, dice.
If I push a half of my chip stack, I push the rest too. Believe me.
My name is Torsten Haase. I'm coming from Germany in the near of Cologne, and I'm unfortunately 42 years old. One evening before, one friend calls me. He booked for the tournament with another friend, and one of them cannot come. And he asked me, do you want to come? And I said, okay, I have nothing special to do, I can try. So this was the story, yes. I'm definitely not a poker pro. I think nobody can see what I think. I look in their eyes and have no problem with this. That's the only advantage I have.
And Torsten is first to speak here. Ace deuce.
Torsten is first to speak.
Suddenly a new aggressive Torsten Haas has appeared.
Or so you thought.
Or so I thought, but at least he contemplated a raise.
Mike McDonald, pocket deuces.
Four-handed on the button. That's going to be an insta raise from Mike. 85,000.
Mike raised 75,000.
Andreas Gullinay entertaining us with some whistling. By entertaining, I mean irritating. Annoying. Oh, good, he stopped. Diego Perez moving all in with Jack 10.
Now he knows that McDonald is raising with all kinds of hands.
Hier, pack mal meine Hände an, lass mich damit gut. Hey!
Nein, geht nicht.
Hase, du gönnst es mir nicht.
Nein, doch.
English, okay.
Du gönnst es mir nicht.
Ich kann das nicht.
I'd rather he go back to whistling.
Really?
Okay. Englisch, nur Englisch.
Kann ich nicht mehr an der Hand.
Warum nicht? Sonst gerne. Bist du abergläubig?
Mike's thinking about it? I don't understand this, James. If things are really good, then he's essentially a coin toss with Diego.
No, not yet. I call.
He's made the call.
Call.
I don't understand this.
This is the biggest gamble we've seen Mike McDonald make.
This is really surprising, James. I don't understand him doing this.
And in this situation, the two overcards are a slight statistical favorite to the pocket pair.
It's because they can make straights as well.
Up comes ace-9-4.
Well, McDonald has dodged the big bullet.
There's still two cards to come, though.
Leading with pocket deuces. Here's the turn.
Perez is hoping he can connect here. A jack or a 10.
A heart won't change anything. And now he's in extremely good shape.
It's got to be a jack. It's got to be a 10. Or Diego Perez is out of this tournament.
It's a queen.
The pocket deuces hold up.
Diego's our fourth place.
Diego Perez finishes in fourth place. Mike McDonald got very lucky there.
I'm dumbfounded, James. I mean, he didn't get that lucky. It was essentially a coin toss.
Sure.
It's his decision that I'm just amazed by.
Well, with that hand, Mike McDonald takes the commanding chip lead at this final table.
Hi, I'm Mike McDonald. I go by Timex Online. I'm 18 years old and I'm from Waterloo, Canada. My biggest win live is 50 or 60,000 euros. I'm definitely on a pretty solid hot streak, so I'll just try to play my cards well. I'm on a bit of a heater in live tournaments. I'm trying to play my best poker at all times. Like, I don't really want to travel overseas and then like play my C game. Yesterday, my dad was watching at work with a bunch of his coworkers on EPT Live, so he's excited.
Well, I retract my comment about Mike McDonald being very lucky on that hand, but at the same time, a questionable call.
You know, James, I'm hesitant to question Mike McDonald's decision processes. The guy is really, I think, a near genius poker player, and he knew exactly where he stood. The thing about pocket deuces is any two cards are over cards. If he had thought Diego Perez had ace deuce, well, okay, fine. I'm sure he had a plan. I mean, he must have known exactly what the situation was and why he wanted to do it, but I think I would have laid it down.
Lee, you know how much I love doing this to you. We're getting ever closer to crowning a champion. Who's your money on?
I think it's gonna be McDonald. I really like his chances. He's playing beautifully, and he got lucky this one key time he had to. It's gonna be hard to stop him now.
Well, let's see how the action plays out. Here in Dortmund.
And they're all gonna have very big paydays, James.
Torsten has ace five of clubs.
Come on, Torsten, you can do it. Three-handed, you've got the button, and ace is all you needed to see. I think he's gonna pull the trigger, James.
Mike McDonald sitting there in the small blind. Andreas in the big blind. Torsten makes it 75,000 to play.
Torsten raised to 75,000.
Mike's got king, queen.
Call.
Suited in spades, he'll make the call.
Interesting, very interesting. Again, it's because he feels that he can outplay Haas after the flop. Against other players, he might re-raise.
Gulenay is going to come along for the ride. 8-10 off suit.
Boy, that really confuses the situation. Now Mike is probably wishing that he had re-raised.
And the flop comes. Queen, five, tray.
Well, Mike has hit his queen. He checks top pair.
Andreas checks.
He thought he could get a bet from Gulenay.
He might get a bet from Haas, though, because he's got second pair.
Yeah, it looks like he got the customer he wanted. He didn't expect it to be Torsten, but he's getting his customer.
15.
And Thorsten makes a bet.
It's 150,000.
Now McDonald wants Gulliney out of the pot.
150,000.
All in.
Mike, re-raise all in.
1.8 million. Of course, what he's saying is, if either of you guys want to stay in, you're all in. Gulliney's out.
Call.
And Hearts calls very quickly.
Very quickly.
King, queen of spades is the hand.
He really should have thought about what he might be up against there.
I mean, you might have eventually put Mike on a flush draw and put the money in.
But think about it first.
Absolutely. I don't understand how he could make that call so quickly.
Thorsten needs to improve here. He needs an ace or a five, or he will be our third place finisher.
Let's see the turn. Turn cut is a tray, is no help.
Still an ace or a five needed.
Thorsten needs a five or an ace.
Mike McDonald standing up, Thorsten sitting down, even though he's the player at risk.
It's a four.
Well, he's going to have to stand up now. He's out the tournament. Mike McDonald has eliminated Thorsten Haas. He finishes in third place. He wins €307,000. We are now heads up here in Dortmund. It will be either Mike McDonald of Canada or Andreas Gulliney of Germany who is the champion of the Dortmund leg of the European Poker Tour. Welcome back to the final table of the Dortmund leg of EPT Season 4. We're heads up, two players left, Mike McDonald of Canada and the entertaining local favourite, Andreas Gulliney. McDonald's got experience and a big chip lead, but Gulliney's luck might just be able to carry him all the way across the finishing line. So 3 million for Mike McDonald, 1.1 million for Andreas Gulliney.
Before the flop. This time it's Mike, and he makes a call.
Mike's just going to call from the small blind with 10-9 of diamonds. Gulliney will check his option. We're going to see a flop lead.
Flop comes king.
Yes, this is a situation where Mike feels that he can outplay Gulliney, so he's willing to play some flops.
Turn cut 7.
He knows his 9 is the stone-cold nuts at this point.
Bet 40,000.
Gulliney's taken a stab at it. He's put 40,000 out there. A quick call from Mike McDonald.
River shows a 4.
Pair of nines are still good. Gulliney, is he going to bluff at it on the river? No, he checks.
Andreas check.
A value bet from Mike McDonald?
Absolutely. This is a value bet from Mike. He knows that 9 is good.
Mike bets.
Is this allowed?
It's okay. 70,000.
70,000. A quick fold from Andreas. First
Mike
blood, Mike McDonald.
And this is what we can expect to see.
Fast play.
So Andreas is first to speak.
So it heads up, the button acts first, post the small blind. Andreas has got an ace, and we know that ace is a very strong card, heads up. Doesn't matter what your kicker is.
As I said, McDonald wants to play flops, James.
And queen eight of hearts. Worth making a speculative call.
Absolutely. Absolutely. He's going to know if he hits the flop or not.
Flop is 5.
He just hit the flop.
Hit that Mike flop. Checks. Top pair. Just ace high for Andreas, but he was the pre-flop raiser. And that's why he's going to continue to show strength, betting 140,000.
If Mike was going to call the raise, this is the flop he was looking for. He's not slowing down now. He may just
Mike
call.
Calls.
Sure enough.
We've got a pot building here. There's 450,000 in the middle.
Turn cut is a queen.
Trip queens now for Mike McDonald.
Mike checks. Check. Andreas checks.
Check, check. He's trying to set up a trap.
River shows a 10.
The problem is, Andreas doesn't have anything but ace high.
No.
Now Mike.
All in. Bet all in.
Oh,
Mike.
Look at that. Look at that. It looks like a bluff. That is exactly what he's trying to say. It looks like he's trying to steal the pot with nothing. He knows that there's no way that Andreas was checking a queen on the turn.
And Andreas is thinking, if this is an absolute steal, ace high just might be good.
Exactly. Mike's play has worked to perfection. He's got Andreas thinking that his ace might actually
Andreas
be good.
Andreas pass, and Mike wins.
He's not going to risk his entire tournament on that decision, though. He folds, and the pot goes over to Mike McDonald.
But now look at the confusion that McDonald has instilled in Gallinet.
And notice that Mike didn't show the hand.
Hey, könnt ihr mal einen Bernd am School besuchen?
No free information here.
Absolutely not. Getting information out of McDonald's is like getting gold out of Fort Knox. It just doesn't happen.
Did you not see Goldfinger?
The gold ended up back in Fort Knox, you'll recall.
Option for Andreas.
Good point. Queen 7 against A7.
Andreas raised 80,000.
This is another 80,000, a total of 110. And again, Mike making the speculative call. And this time he's in position, of course.
He's in position now. He's actually dominated. If a 7 comes, there could be trouble for McDonald. But again, he's going to use his position and what he believes to be his superior skills.
5, deuce, tray. Andreas is first.
They both miss.
This pot will go to the first person that puts chips in.
200.
Good bet. Very good bet.
Almost the size of the pot.
McDonald's not going to risk it. He knows that he has got better places to put his money in, and he's not going to do it here.
Mike pass, Andreas wins.
So Andreas gets some back. Mike McDonald still with the dominant chip lead. He's got most of the pink chips. They're the ones which are worth 10,000, of course.
The brown ones are worth 5,000 each, and the blue ones, 1,000. You may notice now, James, that they've abandoned the antes at their heads up. Very strong hand for Gallinet. Heads up, ace jack is a very, very big hand.
Raised to 100,000.
Makes it 100,000.
Once again, Mike is dominated.
Mike calls.
If a jack comes, Andreas could double up.
Jack nine, a very playable hand, though.
Very much so, and that's the problem, that if the flop comes jack high, McDonald will almost certainly put all his chips in.
Flop comes king, tray.
Now,
four.
Fortunately for McDonald, checks. They both missed.
And check.
And they both check.
Turn card is a queen.
Now McDonald has got the inside straight draw. 10 would make his straight.
His problem is if a 10 comes, Gallinet makes the absolute stone cold nuts.
Of course. But against an unknown hand, that's what he's playing here. He's playing that draw.
He's not playing the draw. He's playing to move Gallinet off whatever he has. This is what really power poker is about, James. I don't care what you have. I'm
Andreas
betting.
Andreas makes the call.
He's got to be concerned about that call, though.
Absolutely. He didn't want to call, and I can't imagine any more money is going to go in, unless a 10 comes.
He's an ace.
McDonald's got to put the brakes on now.
Mike he certainly will.
Bet all in.
Gallinet is giving Mike McDonald a taste of his own medicine.
Mike Parson.
Now, see, that's a very interesting situation. I think Gallinet made a huge mistake going all in there, because if he got called, he was losing.
It was a very scary board for a single pair.
Absolutely. He could have run into a situation like two pair for McDonald or whatever. It was a very different situation when McDonald had trip queens, because he knew he had the best hand.
Mike McDonald is first to speak. Ace king, that's what you want to see. And hope that your opponent's got ace queen.
Actually, you want to see aces, but that's how it goes. Now, they've been doing this sort of raise and call, and so Andreas wants to look at a flop, and that's fine.
Andreas calls.
If the flop comes 10 high, then he's probably in good shape. Or maybe he'll hit something like ace 7-7 and double up.
Flop comes king, 7,
top pair for Mike McDonald. Bottom pair for Andreas. Andreas checks to Mike McDonald.
And remember, when he checks, McDonald is going to bet 100% of the time. So you really don't get any information.
Andreas is going to raise.
Andreas wants to raise him. Wants to find out if his seven's good. He'll get a very quick answer here. If he gets called or raised, he's got to be done with the hand.
You would think so.
Mike just flat calls.
And Mike makes a call. 300.
Unless Andreas improves on the turn,
king,
surely he's got to put the brakes on.
McDonald is weaving a web.
That call should have sent him a message.
This is a terrible card.
Andreas is first.
From a Bayesian perspective, that means given the two cards that he sees there, the two kings, he likes his seven more. He doesn't know now that he's drawing dead. He actually is now thinking, hey, this seven is good.
Because the statistical chance of my opponent having a king is so much less.
Exactly. And he thinks he can probably move Mike off something.
Bet 300,000.
Mike's loving this.
His only question is, does he pull the trigger now or on the river?
He's got trip kings with an ace kicker and his opponent's betting into him.
He has seen Andreas go all in before with relatively weak situations.
And Mike calls 300,000.
The web is closing around Gulenay here.
A call on the flop, a call on the turn. That should tell him something, though, shouldn't it?
Andreas should be sensing.
River card is a deuce.
Even if he's not worried about the king, what about the jack?
Exactly. He should be worried about the jack at the very least.
Got a lot to think about.
McDonald doesn't sit around making speculative calls like that. He's not on a flush draw. He might make that play with a jack, but as far as Gulenay is concerned, a jack is just as bad as a king.
I go all in.
Bad move. He's pushed everything into the middle. He's going to get called.
I call.
Mike McDonald will show the trip kings. Andreas Gulenay will show the sevens. We have a champion here in Dortmund. Mike McDonald has just won the title. He has taken out Andreas Gulenay. He will finish second. He will win 528,000 euros. But Mike McDonald from Canada, just 18 years old, will take the title. He'll take the prize money, 933,000.
Our champion here, the Dortmund EPT. We're all so proud of you. How do you feel?
I feel pretty good. I was happy about my play today and things worked out well.
Well, pretty much everyone that went out off the final table said they picked you as the eventual winner. So you've been playing amazingly well. Is there anywhere in this game that you knew it was yours?
I mean, I don't know, once he shoved that river and wasn't happy when I called, I was pretty sure it was mine. But before that, like, it could have been anyone's game, I guess.
Well, the short stacks went early here in Dortmund. Christian Harder and Thibaut Durand. Johannes Strassmann, if he'd been a bit less aggressive, maybe he would have done better. Good results for Claudio Diego and Torsten. Commiserations to Andreas Gulenay. Congratulations to our champ, Mike McDonald.
So it's been another biggie and another champion crowned. And all that's left for us now is to go and sample a few of the local German delicacies. You know, I hear the beer's good here. Oh, and hold on to your winter woolies because it's next stop, Copenhagen.
Another young champion has been crowned. He's still got braces on his teeth, as well as the money. He gets a seat in Monte Carlo. Remember, we're moving ever closer to the grand final of this season of the EPT. But we'll see you next in Copenhagen in Denmark.